So I'm joined here today by the Conservative councillor for the Wish Ward, Robert Nemeth. Welcome back to Latest News. So, yeah, it's been a while since, well, it's May local elections, you were re-elected. So we're some way into the new council now. So how's it been for you? What's going on, particularly at ward level?
I think the biggest change has been the bin problems that the city's seen. That's the one thing that everybody's now bombarding councillors with, saying, why is there suddenly bin problems? And everyone's making up their own, you know, answers as to why that's happening. But I'm happy to talk a bit more as to what I think it's all about.
OK, so that's something that's come up on the doorstep. So is that in the... How far is that in the council's control, the refuse collection?
Unlike, you know, many surrounding councils, Brighton and Hove attempts to empty bins and recycling through an in-house service called City Clean.
Yes.
And so when people talk about City Clean being this other organisation to the side, it's just the council.
Yes, OK. So it is quite a lot in their control. They've had some issues with kind of potential strikes in the past, haven't they? Has that kind of impacted upon...
Well, I mean, the suspicion... I mean, levels? Most residents feel sort of accept and, you know, it's worth investigating that there's essentially unofficial strikes going on. So that could be the sudden spike in staff sickness or the sudden number of refuse lorries that are out of action.
OK.
I mean, it's a coincidence. It could be just all a big coincidence, but it just feels... It must be linked, so...
Yeah, and you've seen that... That's quite widespread throughout your ward, is that...
Yeah, right? I mean, we don't have that many communal bins, so it's not stacking up in the same way that it is in Central Hove and, you know, the central areas of Brighton. But, I mean, everyone comes into Central Hove and Central Brighton, so we can all see these just massive piles of rubbish outside shops and outside people's houses and blowing down the streets into front gardens. And standard wheelie bins just aren't being emptied either.
And how can that be redressed then? What would be your kind of solution to those ongoing problems?
Well, obviously a change of council. I mean, people voted for a certain way and that's their right, but it was inevitably going to end in the sort of chaos we've seen. It was very much predicted. We don't have this chaos in surrounding local authority areas, so vote differently. That's the solution.
Right, OK. Now, moving on to the King Alfred, I know you predicted in the past that there was going to be issues there. Mm. So where are we at the King Alfred? Because, there's nothing going on there. It's kind of a site that needs updating and there's been nothing really going on for a number of years now. And Brexit was the reason put forward by the developers about the plans, the recent plans not going ahead. But where do you see it?
So in terms of reasons, there's two reasons. There's Chris Nicholson, which was the picked, you know, the bid winner, shall we say, that was picked to build the King Alfred, pulling out perhaps after exaggerating figures during the process. They made it sound easier than it actually was to build it, got picked, weren't able to build it. And then very poor mismanagement on behalf of the council. So, for example, the council didn't take any sort of deposit. So they let this scheme just... you know, ferment for 3 years without any without anything happening. You know, 3 years just wasted. And every year you're wasting on if it does turn out to be a residential scheme, it's £1 million a year of lost council tax. You know, tens of thousands of pounds of council officer time that could be going to much more pressing causes, like, you know, solving the rough sleeping crisis or any other. Solving the bin crisis, any other council matter that you can name that you feel strongly about. So two things: poor leadership at the council. I mean, the council didn't even have a councillor that was in charge of the project, and then Chris Nicholson behaving very badly indeed.
Yeah, because we're back to square one now, aren't we? So just for viewers that watch and might not understand the planning process, and I'm not an expert by any stretch of imagination, but do we have to start from square one again now? So it's a whole finding a new developer.
So there is no planning anyway. We didn't even... I mean, it was so protracted that the developer, Chris Nicholson, didn't even get to put in plans. So we're that far away anyway. So it doesn't have to be as bad as it sounds. We're pretty near to stage one anyway, because nothing's being done after they had been picked. So that's fair. Now that they're gone, it's fairly unavoidable that you've got to start near the bottom anyway.
And do you see someone coming forward now? I mean, it is quite a prime site, isn't it? So I can't... There's going to be interest, surely.
Yeah, loads of interest. I mean, any councillor that has any link at all to King Alfred, like myself, every week gets a different approach from someone saying, I could do this. And then at some point, a proper process will decide who of those people is actually serious. But it's a dream project. It's one of the best sites in the country. It's big. It has the potential for exciting architecture. So.
And we still want to see a revamp of the King Alfred Leisure Centre, don't we? Ideally, I mean, it looks dated, doesn't it? That leisure
centre. I mean, the Conservative group on the council's got four tests. I mean, first of all, we want to see a 50-metre pool there. So if this whole deal collapses, which seems to be very likely, we want a 50-metre pool. We want a King Alfred on that site, so we don't want it pushed away into a suburb where no one can walk there anymore or there's no bus routes. I mean, it's got to be on the shop front of Hove. You know, the seafront. We want to see the deal to... I mean, you were right to ask about sports. I mean, it should be 100% about sports, and there should be no doubt in anyone's mind. This is a sports centre. It's not a housing scheme. And the fourth test, maybe the most important in terms of actually delivering it, is whoever's picked going forward, or whatever method is used to pick them, there has to be some sort of deposit, there has to be some sort of financial penalty for whoever's picked. So they can't just drag the council along and the people of the city, and there'd be no consequence. Chris Nicholson can just walk away and, you know, they might have spent money on their own fees, but there should be a penalty if you treat people that badly.
Yeah. OK, I know that there's a local election. We've had a local election. There's going to be a general election almost certainly coming up. Any ideas about who the Conservative candidates might be in and around the three seats? You know,
well,
Vivian Kemp,
yeah,
Town,
sure.
And Hove.
So my good friend Councillor Joe Miller has been picked as the Kemp Town candidate. So this is the east of the city and
Lord Russell Moore's seat. Yep.
Yes, that's correct, but maybe not for long. Joe's a great candidate. Brighton Pavilion hasn't been picked yet, and Hove there'll be depending on when this goes to air. There's a selection meeting this very week.
Okay, any ideas who might be standing there? Or
well, we keep our cards close to our chest until we've got somebody that we can hold up and really get behind. So, but okay. they'll be a great candidate.
Okay, we'll get back to you on that as and when there's more developments. Thanks for coming in, Robert.
Thank you.